Hey, this is Matt once again. What about the end of the video? It's another paid request, this time for Curtis. Thank you so much for that. And for those interested in requesting any type of videos, topics, reactions, commentaries, reviews, re-reviews, what have you, feel free to send it either directly to my PayPal or join my Patreon. Both links are down below in the info box. Now, this is for Phantom of the Paradise from 1974. Now, I think this was a film I saw... God, I can't remember when I saw this. A long time ago. Maybe over 10 years ago. Give or take. And I think what I saw back then, I didn't really get it. Didn't really understand it. And so I didn't really care for it. But I will say, trust me, I know it's been over 10 years and a lot has changed in over 10 years. And I've seen a lot more movies since then, and I liked it. Watch it again. Phantom of the Paradise. I liked it. I thought it was a pretty interesting take on the Phantom of the Opera, with a bit of the rock and roll style in this point. Little bit of Rocky Horror Picture Show flavor. And it's directed by Brian De Palma, and this is, I think, before he did Carrie. Well before he did Scarface and The Untouchables and other movies. All films I do like. I mean, my favorite is Scarface. I even like, despite some flaws, I like Snake Eyes with Nicolas Cage, what Brian De Palma did. I don't even mind that film. And even, what did he do? Mission to Mars? I didn't mind that film either, despite some effects that don't hold up the best. But I do like Mission to Mars. Now, this is a film that stars William Finley as Winslow, who becomes our Phantom. You have Paul Williams, who is a singer, and his voice is used for when the Phantom sings. So it's kind of weird. He's playing the villain, but it's also his voice used for the Phantom when he sings. And he was a singer in real life. Very short man. He plays sort of our villain, Swan. You have Jessica Harper, who has our very pretty face, who will be... who the Phantom wants to sing his songs. And, you know, it kind of follows the Phantom, you know, the thing of this guy's songs are being stolen and other stuff happened. He gets disfigured. He wants revenge. He's very much in love with this girl, wanting her to sing his music. But it's definitely doing its own thing as well. And William Finley, I recognize the guy. He was in Silent Rage with Chuck Norris. He was one of the doctors who made the villain come back to life. The villain of a Kirby. And I love that Chuck Norris film, Silent Rage. But he was one of the doctors. He's been a few other stuff, too. And pretty much the villain, Paul Williams, wants this paradise, this ultimate rock palace. So at one point, there's this 50s-style band called the Juicy Fruits playing. And one at least another, Swan, played by Paul Williams, I'll just call him by his tears, named Swan, here's this music that William Finley is playing, and says, I like that music, we need that music. Just kind of tricked it out of him, and despite some angry outbursts, William Finley is a bit pretty naive. He thinks, oh yeah, you don't give me a job? Sure. You don't work with me? Sure. And then like a month goes by, he goes over, he gets fucked over, and one thing leads to another, he's brought to jail. And just shit rolls downhill. I mean, in jail because of some infestation. They gotta tape people's teeth out. So he's got this, like, metal teeth in there. He escapes to get revenge. And it's pretty goofy how this happened. Like, he trips and then kind of puts his face in here into, like, a record press so that his face gets burnt. The way that was done was pretty wonky. But I will say the film, number one, is a short film. It's only an hour and 20-some... I think it was only like an hour and 20-some minutes. The music is very catchy. I especially like the end credits. I didn't mind some of the other songs. I never thought I'd get to meet the devil, but meet him face to face. Some, like I said, the music was catchy for what it needed to be. It's a very colorful film with the set design. It's very stylish. Brian De Palma even here brought some style to it. Even the look of the Phantom, the metal helmet thing looked really cool. It's a very unique look of the Phantom and really stood out. I really did like that outfit. I mean, the cloak, whatever, the tape, or whatever, I think it was a cape, but that helmet looked really cool, and the way the eyes kind of lit through it, is really striking image. And even early on, De Palma's implementing those camera tricks that he would utilize more in Carrie and Blowout, which is another good movie. I'm not big on the ending, just personal taste, but I do think it is a good movie. And, there's split screens, there's POV shots, tracking POV shots. There's a bit where the Phantom is going to put this bomb in this car during this musical program as revenge. So it's a split screen of like where the bomb's at to where the Phantom's looking down and other things going on. And then there's POV shots in certain sequences. The set design, like I said, is very interesting. Like, there's a bit where the villain Swan, he's in this table, and the table looks like a big old record, which I thought looked really neat. And he's trying to think of what kind of, by this point, he's got the Phantom controlled. And trying to bullshit, hey, I'll work with you, blah, blah, blah. And while the Phantom wants this girl to sing, Swan's like, well, she's too good. I need someone with a little bit other quality to her. So as he's sitting in the middle of this record, and there's blackness all around, as he's thinking, these people just pop out. So these folks are singing R&B. This guy's singing country music. Not quite. And then you get to Derek Graham, who I remember as the really piece of shit stepdad in Child's Play 2. How's the Hanging Phil? You know, that guy, he's in this. He was also Bud the Chud in Chud 2. I know you want to forget that, but yeah, that was Derek Graham. He's been a few other stuff too, but he's here as this, like, glam rock guy. He's kind of funny. He's a little bit, at times, feminine. Like, oh my, like, he gets frightened by the Phantom in the shower and gets, like, a plunger in his face. And he wants to do the smart thing. He's like, hey, when a dead guy's warning me, I need to go. But he does listen to the other people and still goes on with the show. So, like I said, it has a nice energy to it. I never really got that bored with it. I mean, Sally, you don't get a lot of development for, like, Jessica Harper's character. You just know that she wants to be a singer. Like, you don't really know much else about her. It's still kind of weird that the Phantom will believe. He says he doesn't believe, but he still believes Paul Williams' character despite all the shit he's done. But like I said, I do think the actors, for the camp quality that this film is, play their parts as well as they could. Like I said, the Silver Man, like I said, the nice style, direction, camera work, and design is, and the music is definitely the star of the film. Also, I thought it was interesting that this brought in the Faustian deals supernatural, because there were at least from the stuff I've seen of Phantom of the Opera, that was really part of it. So this brought at least a little bit of a different thing where you find out, spoiler alert, super spoilers, that Paul Williams had done a deal, that he'll be young, and he's pretty much sold his soul to the devil. And then there's a point where the Phantom sees this girl that he loves with Paul Williams and tries to stab himself, but Paul's like, hey, Swan's like, hey, this contract, I own your ass. Yeah, you may be bleeding, but that wound ain't gonna do shit. I own you. You don't die until I die. So tough titty. Now, there's a bit that I thought was kind of weird, where after all this shit's going on, and it really jumps ahead to now all of a sudden, I was a bit confused with this. Jessica Harper, I know she wants to do anything to, she wants to do anything to be a singer, but then, am I to assume she got drunk or she got drugged? Or because she was forced into this deal, then she was doing it against her desire to do so, to get married to Swan's character. I guess we're meant to assume that he got her drunk or doped up or something and then made her sign without her realizing. And then that's why she was so gung-ho on marrying the guy. Because earlier she's like, I'm not going to, there's this other meeting early on. In the first, like, 15 minutes of the movie, she's like, she runs out going, I'm not doing that, I'm a singer. So I'm assuming maybe that's what happened later on. But around that time, the Phantom goes into the, like, security room, whatever you want to call it, and has the absolute best luck I've ever seen in a movie where a guy gets the right security footage at the right time. Just thankfully, as soon as he goes in, boom, there's the footage that tells him the whole story of Swan. That thankfully was filming both sides. Yeah, there were cameras. Thankfully, this guy was filming both of them. I mean, I know he explains why. I know I'm getting confusing. The Phantom sees footage that many, many years ago, Swan tried to end himself. And he was filming it because I can't let myself get old and ugly. And I'm going to film it because he gave a reason why. And then I guess the devil appeared and gave him a Faustian deal. So then he's going to be young forever. And his oldness is going to be in this footage. Kind of the Dorian, was it Dorian Gray? Where you remain young but your picture gets older. Only this case is the footage or the picture in the footage. But thankfully the Phantom found that, and there's no locked in key security, at least much worth a shit. And then he like turns to look at all these security cameras, and thank God the security camera is aiming right at this assassin that's going to kill the lady. Like, this security camera like captures everything. It captures, boom, that's the guy, and that's the assassin, and I swear the camera like pushes in. I'm like, who the fuck? Maybe it didn't push in, but it's like, it, or like it went to a better angle. I'm like, who's controlling this footage? I just thought it was, we have to find a way to get this information across as soon as possible, as quick as possible. It might not be the most logical or the most strongly written way of doing it. Just get along with it. I'm like, okay. There is a nice directing trick, though, where the camera like pushes into one of the screens, and then that becomes the rest of the scene. It's a nice transition. You don't really feel the horror. Like, people are in the Phantom of the Opera, and you like the horror aspect. You might be put off with this, because you don't really feel a lot of horror from the Phantom. I'm not saying he doesn't kill anybody, but it's just maybe you don't feel as much as other versions. And I kind of wish they had done the ending a bit differently. The super spoilers, because he's able to save the girl from this assassination. He's able to save the girl again from Swan trying to fuck her up and stabs him. And now that he destroyed the footage before that, now people know how ugly and fucked up he is. Since the deal is done. Because again, before he rescued the girl, he destroyed the footage and all the videotapes. It was kind of funny that the crowd's so into it. They're just part of the show. They give Swan the wave and going around. They're just part of the show. But it's just depressing. I guess that's the point. Tragic. That he's dying because that wound opens up and he's trying to reach for the girl. He can't talk because of his teeth. And then as soon as he dies, then the girl realizes who he is and holds him. I'm like, at least give the guy one moment of satisfaction. At least give him one moment of happiness. At least give him one moment of... At least one moment of... He looks up for her, smiles, and then... At least one moment. Like, come on. Come on. I mean, I get what he's doing, but... Like, the Dead Zone did that well. The girl just truthful walked in, he has one moment. That's what I'm asking for. What would be in the Dead Zone after this? So yeah, while it's more rock and roll and comedic that maybe hardcore Family Opera fans might be disappointed in it, it's definitely a unique take. It's an energetic take. There's some nice directing choices. It's a very colorful, different, unique set designs. Some pretty decent music. Other than some nitpicks here and there, I definitely could say I like this more than I did originally. And maybe because I've seen some other Phantom of the Opera films. I've seen various other types of films. So I just learned to appreciate this a bit more. And it's a very 70s movie. If you're into 70s get-up and aesthetics, this is a movie for you. Like I said, it has not quite as campy a Rocky Horror Picture Show, but it does lean a bit more into that quality. Again, not as much as Rocky Horror, but a little bit of that. So it's Phantom of the Paradise is definitely an interesting film, and I do appreciate it for that. Like I said, it's just, even William Finley as the Phantom, it seems like there's not a whole lot of room for deeper terrorization. I guess that's the point, is it's not trying to be that type of movie. Maybe a little bit more retrospection from the Phantom, maybe a little bit more development with Jessica Harper's character, maybe a little bit more for the ending, just a little bit more. Or hell, let's change the pace, let's not have the Phantom die. That'd be a nice change of pace. Why don't we go, since you're going so much off the beaten path, have him, well, he did kill some people, to be fair, so. This is a movie where the Phantom lives. That'd be different. But, anyway, whatever. Interesting, you know, fun little movie. Interesting also to see where early stage of Brian De Palma, and then where he goes after this. So with that said, thanks for watching. Take care. We'll see you guys later.